melacha, our work, our labors. You have your scriptures open with me to the book of Tehillim, the book of Psalms, chapter 29, as we open up our service today. With God thundering throughout his creation, a psalm of David. He writes, ascribe to Adonai, O sons of God. Ascribe to Adonai, kavod, glory and strength. Ascribe to Adonai the glory of his name. Bow down to Adonai in the beauty of holiness. The voice of Adonai is over the waters. The God of glory thunders. Adonai is over mighty waters. The voice of Adonai is powerful. The voice of Adonai is full of majesty. The voice of Adonai breaks the cedars. Yes, Adonai shatters the cedars of Lebanon. He makes Lebanon skip like a calf, Sirion like a young wild ox. The voice of Adonai hews out flames of fire. The voice of Adonai shakes the desert. Adonai shakes the wilderness of Kadesh. The voice of Adonai makes the deer writhe in birth and strips forests bare. And in his temple all are saying, kavod, glory. Adonai sits enthroned above the flood, over the flood. Yes, Adonai sits as king forever. He gives strength to his people. Adonai blesses his people with shalom. If you'd stand with me today, God is thundering throughout creation. The Lord is in this place. So, Lord, we do thank you this morning that you would be with us today. We thank you that you're here, Lord, as we worship you, as we praise you, as we honor you, as we read from your word, as we pray to you, as we fellowship with one another, Lord, and exhort and encourage each other, Lord. It's been a long week for some, Lord, that they are just so grateful. We're all grateful to just be here on this day of rest. So, Lord, as we recite back to you your words, the Matovu prayer among the Jewish people, we thank you, Lord, that this prayer continues to have application to us thousands of years after it was penned. Let's recite the Matovu together. Matovu. O Halecha Yaakov, Mishkenotecha Israel. Oh, how goodly are your tents, O Jacob, your dwelling places, O Israel. Lord, we love your house and your honor's dwelling place. We ask you, Lord, would you answer each and every one of us today with Yeshua, your true and only salvation? We count on it, Lord. In the name of the Messiah, Yeshua. Amen. Amen. Do me a quick favor. Cross the aisle. Introduce yourself to your neighbor, maybe to somebody you've never met before. Welcome them to Tree of Life today. Kids would come on down. We want to bless you. All right. The Birkat Habanim, the blessing of the children. This is done in Eretz Yisrael. It's done in the diaspora as our kids return home from the synagogue. And it's our privilege to bless you today from the Word of God. And we know you're excited. Thank you all for presenting last Shabbat. What a wonderful encouragement to us of your knowledge of the Word and your heart filled with faith. So for the girls, we say over them from the Scriptures, Yisimech Elohim, Kesara, Rivka, Rachel, Velea. May God make you like Sarah and Rebecca, and Rachel and Leah, the blessed mothers of the Jewish people. And for you boys, Yishimcha Elohim, Ke'ephraim v'chi Menashe. May God make each one of you boys like Ephraim and Manasseh as you build up Israel in your young generation. Abba, we bless you for our Yeladim, our children. Father, we thank you, Lord, as they continue to grow up as straight Azechayim, trees of life, at tree of life. Lord, we thank you that all of your fullness will come upon them. Even today, Lord, bless their teachers, the teachers' assistants, those watching in the nursery as well, oh God, that they would continue to be as excited as we are to be in the house of the Lord. We bless you for their lives in the name of Yeshua HaMashiach. Amen. 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 Kids, thanks for being here today. We'll see you back a little later. Al, if you'd come up, Daniel, if you'd remain forward as well. We're going to open the Ark of the Lord today. We're going to process the Sefer Torah through the synagogue today. It is our opportunity to express affection, not for ink on papyrus or a scroll, but the author of the scroll, Adonainu, our Lord. Let's continue to stay standing as we open up the Lord's Ark today. Let's open the ark with these words. Vayhi ben soh ha'aron, vayomer Moshe, kuma Adonai, ve'afutsu ho'ivecha, ve'hanusu misanecha, mipanecha. Ki mitzion tetzei Torah. Ki mitzion tetzei Torah. Udvar Adonai meYerushalayim. Baruch Shenatan Torah, Torah, Baruch Shenatan, Torah, Torah, Le'amo Yisrael, Bihikdu Shato.
Come on, 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 come on
Hallelujah. Father, you're mighty to save. And Lord, we recite back to you again your word, the anthem of our people, the Shema today. Shema Yisrael, Adonai Eloheinu, Adonai Echad, Boruch Shem, Kivod Mahalchuto, Leolam Avad. Hear, O Israel, the Lord is our God. The Lord is one. Blessed is the name of his glorious Malchut, his kingdom, which is forever and ever. Amen.
Amen. Amen. Amen. Amen. He is breath. Our Lord, our Messiah. We can trust in him. We can put all our trust in him, no matter what it is. We can trust in him. for us. We will dance. We will worship the Lord our God. We will praise his name with our lives. We shall clap our hands unto him and bless his holy name. We will lift our hands before the Lord and lift his name and praise his name forever. Hallelujah.
Every
Yeah. none like you, Lord. None like you, hallelujah. Hallelujah. There's none like our God. Ein Kelochinu. There's none like our God. Ein Kadonim. There's none like our King. Ein Kemalchinu. None like our Lord. Ein Kemoshinu. None like our Messiah. Hallelujah. Thank you. Yeah.
spirit of worship this morning, wanted to recognize and say Kaddish for Robert Nunez, who was Magdalena's oldest brother, who passed away recently. And although we don't often do this every time someone who goes on to be with the Lord, those of you who have had a loved one who has passed in the past year, if you would remain standing, I'm going to ask Joe to come forward to lead us in Kaddish this morning.
Yit gadal v'yit kadash shemerabah v'yama divra chirute v'yamlich machute v'chayachon uv'yomechon uv'chaye dekol beit Israel ba'agila uvizman kariv v'imru amen. Yehe shemer ba mevarech leolam ul almei almaya. Yit barach v'yishtabach v'yit pa'ar v'yit romam v'yit nase v'yit hadar v'yit ale v'yit hada halal shemed churisha brichu. Le ele min kol berchata v'shirata tushbechata v'nechemata da'amiran v'alma v'imru. Amen. Yehe shlama rabba min shamaya v'chaim aleinu v'al kol Yisrael v'imru. Amen. Osei shalom v'imromav hu ya'ase shalom aleinu v'akol Yisrael v'imru. Amen. Magnified and sanctified may God's great name be throughout the world,
yes,
which he created according to his will. May he establish his kingdom in our lifetime and during our days and with the life of the entire house of Israel, speedily and soon, and we say, amen.
Amen. Thank you, Lord.
May the greatness of his name be blessed forever and ever. Let the name of the Holy One, blessed be he, be blessed and praised, glorified and exalted, extolled and honored, adored and lauded, beyond all of the blessings and songs, praises and consolations that are ever spoken in this world. And we say, amen.
Amen.
May there be abundant peace from heaven and life for us and for all Israel, as we say, amen. And may he who creates peace in the high heavens create peace for us and for all Israel, as we say, amen.
Amen. Thank you, Joe. You may be seated. Wanted to periodically give vent to our remembrance. Magdalena, if you're in here, I want to express our condolences to you as a congregation. For all those who have lost loved ones in this past year, it's just a way, it's not a prayer for the dead, it's a prayer of the sovereignty of God. So we recognize the Lord gives and the Lord takes away. And Magdalena, we believe that you're going to be a continuing light in your own family as you share the Messiah, Yeshua, with your family. And we know that there's a time of mourning, and that time in Judaism is a one-year process, and it gets lighter as the year goes on, and we don't take it lightly, and the Lord allows us in our tradition to grieve accordingly. I'm going to ask the ushers to come forward this morning. You have a number of items in your pew, communication card. If this is your first time this morning, we encourage you to fill that out completely, especially your email address, so we can get to know you and send out e-blasts to you on events coming up. You have an offering envelope, a tithe envelope as well. You have a Passover Seder registration form. I want to encourage you, tomorrow morning we will have a video announcement playing in Skyline for them to begin registering for the Seder. And Jessica Molina and Will Hanosh have graciously given of their time over the next three Sundays to sit in the atrium to receive those registrations from Skyline, but we want to get our registrations in as well. It's going to be Sunday afternoon at 3:00 in the gymnasium behind us, April 24th. It's going to be a wonderful time. Those of you who have been with us every year, it's a highlight of our year. We encourage you to fill those out. You can see me after the Seder to give me those registration forms and payments, or you can mail them into our P.O. box. You can download a registration form. If you don't get one here, it's on our website, on the homepage, and we encourage you to get those in as quickly as possible. Well, my friends, while not made of stone or wood, Like the idols that ensnared the Israelites, false gods are still worshipped today in the world. You know, when our people entered Canaan, they found a fertile land bursting at the seams with the best of creation's bounty. A land, the Bible tells us, quote, flowing with milk and honey. But how many of you know that's not the only thing that our people found there? The native Canaanites introduced them to the local fertility god Baal, to whom they credited the overwhelming prosperity and success of their land. Baal was worshipped as the Lord of the weather and the giver of the dew, the giver of rain, which brought forth the earth's vegetation. And so the situation presented new situations and new temptations for our people Israel upon entering the land of Canaan. Would Adonai be able to provide for them as Baal supposedly had provided for the Canaanites? Could they serve both Adonai and Baal? The Israelites should have known the answers to all these questions, and every day they heard the national call to worship, the Shema, which commanded them, love the Lord your God with all of your heart, with all of your soul, and with all of your strength. The command allowed and allows no room for additional gods. Amen. But if we examine ancient forms of idolatry closely, it becomes clear that economic incentives of idolatry are timeless. American materialism could easily be interchanged with the fertility idolatry in Canaan. Just as our people Israel were tempted to serve God and the prosperity idol Baal, we today are tempted to serve both God and money. How many of you know this is idolatry? And we would do well to recall God's command to Israel regarding their new home. Deuteronomy 12, verse 2 says this, destroy completely all the places on the high mountains and on the hills and upon every spreading tree where the nations you are dispossessing worship their gods. Break down their altars, smash their sacred stones, and burn their Asherah poles in the fire. Cut down the idols of their gods and wipe out their names from those places. You must not worship the Lord your God in their way. It's a startling passage. For idolatry's wickedness lies in its denial of our love and trust to God, which are His right as our Creator, and it is His right as our Messiah. God calls His people His bride in Scriptures, and so when we turn to idols, it's like committing adultery against God, defiling ourselves through promiscuity, and so on. Greed defines our relationship and defiles it, actually, with God by making wealth instead of Him the object of our affections. So it's a word, I believe, even for our generation as we look to the Lord and what we would do today and support the house of the Lord here in San Diego, Tree of Life. You can make a tax-deductible gift this morning to Tree of Life. And let's go before our Father with these words. Elohei Avraham, Yitzchak v'Yaakov, Elohei Avotenu, God of Abraham, God of Isaac, God of Jacob, and God of our forefathers. Father, we recognize the false gods here in America. We recognize the false gods that have seeped and creeped into our own hearts. And Father, we periodically have to renounce them, Lord, when we recognize them. Father, we recognize that it is You who gives us the ability to garner wealth to establish Your covenant in the earth. And so we praise You, Lord, that You'll accept back even a tithe this morning as an act of our will, saying we recognize that You are the provider. You are Adonai Yireh. You are Adonai Rofe. You are the God, our healer. It's all You, Lord. It's all about You this morning. And so we give out of a joyful heart and a joyful spirit this morning, B'Shem Yeshua HaMashiach. And all of His people said, amen. Congregation, it's time for the offering today. Thank You, Lord. While that is taking place, I want to just bring you to your bulletins quickly. We have a couple of items of business to take care of, spiritual business. I mentioned the Passover Seder to you. We're going to have a number of guests over the next couple of weeks. I want to encourage you to be here next Shabbat. I was thinking how to introduce our guest speaker next Shabbat, and the verse came to my mind from Psalm 81, I believe. It says very clearly, "Open your mouth and I will fill it." My dentist is going to be here next week, and I felt that was such a great scripture. Dr. Richard Masick has just come out with a book. It's incredible, called Idolatry. God is not your problem. It answers questions: who is God? What is he up to? How does he operate? What does he want? Is he testing you? Is he judging you? Does God allow bad things to happen? What is God's wrath and how does he act on it? Does he change his mind? How do you see him? What is truth? Capital T, who defines it? What is ideology? Why should I care? If God is not my problem, then who is? And I'm getting just started to read his book, and we toured Israel together in 2008. And a number of us will be out of town next Shabbat. But this is a guy you don't want to miss. Nationally renowned dentist and author now, scholar really. And Dr. Richard Masick will be here. We're going to have some worship guests the next Shabbat on the 16th. Emma from Skyland will be with her. Why? My mother and father-in-law are driving tomorrow to Nashville, Tennessee, as we say in Judaism, Nashville, to help my brother and sister-in-law move into a new house that they had built in the suburbs of Nashville, and they're going to be helping them, and so they're going to be gone for a couple weeks, but we've got everything covered, and you don't want to miss these services. Thank you, Mom. Appreciate it. Guys, if you have that MJAA video clip queued up, I want to encourage you. I was back on the East Coast this week helping plan this annual conference that really is the crown jewel of the Messianic movement. Guys, if you have that.
This is the time and the hour of the revival of our Jewish people. The time of the outpouring of the Holy Spirit upon all families of the earth. The hour of prophecy, dreams, and visions. The time to seek the Lord together in one place. And that place to be Messiah 2016. Worship in song and dance with Paul Wilbur, Marty Goetz, Becca Shea, the Klezmeranians, and so many more. The seven-day schedule offers more than 100 classes and sessions. Hear speakers from across the spectrum of Messianic Jewish congregations and ministries. These are days of great trials. Exciting children's programming for all ages with a new interactive program for ages 5 through 10. YMJA, Conference Within a Conference, for ages 13 through 22. Don't miss the Cultural Center and Marketplace, Messianic Dance Instruction, Creative Arts Program,
my wife Darcy is caring for our daughter, who is a patient this morning. She had her wisdom teeth taken out late yesterday. How many of you remember having your wisdom teeth taken out and just the swelling and the pain that goes with that? But she'll be here a little later with the dance team to help prepare them for our Seder. If you have misplaced a set of, looks like, house keys last Shabbat here, please see me afterwards from the Pepper Tree Ranch Senior Apartments. I have your house keys. I want to welcome those of you who are watching online, those of you watching the archive during the week on our website as well as on YouTube, Tree of Life Live from San Diego. We thank you for being here and worshiping vicariously with us. We're so grateful that you're here with us. For those of us here, let's turn in our Bibles quickly to the book of 1 Kefa, 1 Peter chapter 4, where we left off two Shabbats ago. I want to speak to you today about living for the Messiah Yeshua in Acharit HaYamin, in the last days. How many of you believe we are in the end of days, according to prophecy. Yeshua told his followers that they would always collide with their culture. But for us as believers, it's not a military collision. It is a collision of values. It is a collision of truth. And the amazing thing about the messianic faith is that it's transcultural. In other words, there are believers in every culture. The messianic faith is not an American faith. It's not a strictly European faith. It's not an Asian faith or an African one. It is a message. It is a faith for all nations. And as we've seen in our study of 1 Kefa, Peter, the good news of Yeshua applies to every culture because it transforms us into better citizens, better children, better parents, better husbands, better wives, and better workers, which we've been talking about. However, a problem arises when we as followers of the Messiah, Yeshua, try to conform to their culture, to the world's culture, rather than allowing the power of Yeshua to transform us. In America, everybody wants to fit in with the culture. There's a powerful force out there called peer pressure that works to mold and to shape us to be like everyone else. That's why students, my daughter and son's age, want to wear clothes with certain labels. And we pay for that as parents, don't we? Why adults want to drive certain automobiles. But the scriptures tell us that the followers of Yeshua are never going to fit in with the crowd. We will always collide with the culture. Yeshua said this, quote, "Enter through the narrow gate," Matthew chapter 7, verse 13, "for the gate is wide and the way is broad that leads to destruction, and those who enter through it are many. How narrow is the gate, and difficult the way that leads to life, and those who find it are few." That's the danger of trying to run with the culture. The culture is running in the wrong direction. Yeshua came sharing a widely different message. He lived an incredibly different life. His message of love, his message of forgiveness clashed with the culture, clashed with the religious teaching of his day. And as a result of being different, apart from being Messiah and God, Yeshua suffered. The Shaliach, the emissary, Kefa, offers some powerful encouragement about the kind of attitude that you and I should have when we collide with our culture. Let's look at it in verse 1 of chapter 4. "Therefore, since Messiah suffered in the flesh, arm yourselves also with the same attitude. For the one who has suffered in the flesh is finished with sin. As a result, he lives the rest of his time in the flesh, no longer for human desires, but for God's will. For the time is past was sufficient for you to carry out the desires, the desire of the pagans." What were those desires? Living in indecency, lusts, drunken binges. That's what makes us different. We collide with our culture because we have a vastly different attitude on life. But number two, we collide with our culture because we have a radically different attitude about sin. In verse 3, Peter identifies six different areas of sin. And as followers of Messiah Yeshua, we have a different attitude about sin. What is that difference? We used to run toward that sin. Now, hopefully, we're running from that sin. The scriptures teach us clearly we're all sinners. Nobody had to teach us how to lie. Nobody had to teach us how to disobey our parents. That came naturally to some of us even more so. But sin is much more than those six areas of wickedness we read earlier that Peter mentioned. Sin, what is it? Basically, it's a self-centered attitude that puts us at the center of our life universe. It's a small universe. Sin is thinking of ourselves instead of thinking of others. Before you and I became believers, we pursued sin, didn't we? Some of us chased sin down to find it. But once we became Yeshua followers, our attitude changed. What changed? We're now running away from sin. Once you became a believer, it doesn't mean that you'll remain sinless for the rest of your life. But it does mean that you will sin less. You see, when we as believers sin, it breaks our hearts and we confess it and we repent of it as quickly as we can. A person who's not a believer, though, can sin, keep on sinning, never feel that conviction, never feel that remorse unless the Holy Spirit begins drawing them. That's what makes us different. We're running from sin, not toward it. And the third way that we are colliding with our culture is because we have a different attitude about death. I don't know if I have it with me today. Yes, I do. You know, a lot of times preachers get, you know, accused of scare tactics when they're, you know, utilizing altar calls and so on. I want to tell you something. Last Sunday here, Resurrection Sunday here at Skyline, there was an elderly couple, members of Skyline, who were here at the second morning service, and they left the service. And they were immediately in a head-on collision, and the wife died. But we have a different attitude about death. They were believers. Man, if you're going to go, why not go on Resurrection Sunday anyway? But in verse 5, Clementine Jones, James was her name, by the way. In verse 5, Kefa makes a statement about what's going to happen to everyone after we die. Verse 5, but they will have to give an account to the one who stands ready to judge the living and the dead. The scripture says in another place, Hebrews 9:27, just as it is appointed unto men once to die and after this judgment. If you and I have surrendered our lives to the Messiah Yeshua, we don't have to be afraid of death and the judgment that's going to follow death. Here's the difference. We don't fear judgment. Why? Because we know the judge. Yochanan 5:22 says, Yeshua said, the Father does not judge anyone, but has handed over all judgment to the Son. In other words, Yeshua will be the judge everybody is going to stand before. If you know him today as your personal Messiah, you have absolutely nothing to fear. Now, when it comes to eternal judgment, it's a good thing to know the judge. Yes, we are guilty. But Yeshua, the judge, is full of mercy. If you've known him as Messiah and Lord, he will declare you to be righteous. Shaul talked about it, Romans chapter 8, verse 1. Therefore, what? There is no condemnation for those in the Messiah, Yeshua. So as a follower of Messiah, we don't have to fear death. We don't have to fear the judgment following death. And don't be surprised if people in the culture heap abuse on you. Why? We're different. We will always collide with the culture. We have different attitudes about life. We have a different attitude about sin. We have a different attitude about death. But we will also spend eternity in a very different place. Notice verse 6. For this was the reason the good news was proclaimed even to those now dead, so that though they are judged in the flesh before humans, they might live in the ruach, the spirit, before God. This has been interpreted to mean that Yeshua proclaimed the good news who had already died, so that they had another opportunity, we talked about a couple weeks ago, to be born again. We talked about that. And to those who prefer to live lives of sin today, ignoring God, this quote-unquote, supposedly second chance appeal does sound great, doesn't it? Let me tell you, I love the concept of purgatory, a place where we're made spiritually clean, but it's not in the Word of God. I love the concept of reincarnation, not in the Word. Again, the letter to the Messianic Jews, 9:27, tells us it's appointed unto men once to die, and then the judgment. My friends, there is no second chance opportunity to accept the good news. These men and women who died in the days of the Tanakh, who believed as much of God's truth as had been revealed to them, and then died before Yeshua came, joined those who would be delivered through the Messiah's atoning death later on. This is clear from Hebrews chapter 11. And so we are to arm ourselves with the example of those who have gone on before. We must let the good news judge and convict us of sin. And then we have to make teshuvah. We have to make repentance. Now, there's another facet to overcoming persecution from this world and from overcoming rejection from the world. There's another face card to that, and that is by abiding under the shadow of the culmination of history. Yeshua is returning soon, in my opinion, to Eretz Yisrael. Well, we know he's coming back to Israel, that's for certain, but we believe it's soon. Our suffering is going to end at that point. But how do we live in the interim period, in light of the last days? You see, like the other shelichim, like the other emissaries, Peter believed that the return of the Messiah Yeshua was imminent in his generation. And my friends, eschatology has ethical implications. I want to challenge you this morning to think about the spiritual state that you will be in on the day that the Messiah returns. You see, if you're a teenager in this place today, if you're a young adult, you may think most of your life is still ahead of you, and it probably is. But we all know teenagers who have died. If you're 50 or older, you may think you've passed the halfway point in your life. But we know people are even living longer than they've ever lived. My friends, age is a relative thing. When you're 5 years old, 18 sounds really old. When you're 18, 40 years old sounds amazingly old. When you're 40, 70 sounds old. When you're 80, 90 sounds old. And when you're 90, man, nothing sounds old to you. We've got some 80s in here. We don't have any 90s. Whether you're tiny or 90, the scriptures say we are to live in a certain way. What's the way? Look at verse 7. Let's discover how we can live our lives according to the will of God. Look with me, verse 7. Now the end of all things is near, so be self-controlled and sober-minded for prayer. Above all, keep your love for one another constant, for love covers a multitude of sins. Be hospitable one to another without grumbling. As each one has received a gift, use it to serve one another as good stewards of the many-sided grace of God. Whoever speaks, let it be as one speaking the utterances of God. Whoever serves, let it be with the strength that God supplies. So in all things may God be glorified through Messiah Yeshua, All glory and power to him forever and ever. Amen. Three important directives we need to understand and obey from these final verses today I want to take up with you. Number one, three of them, prayer, love, and service. Number one, prayer. Prayer. Pray with a sense of urgency. Guys, if you have that other video clip, get it ready. Verse 7 again says, now the end of all things is near, so be what? Self-controlled, sober-minded for prayer. We've all, most of us anyway, have watched football, and the two-minute warning comes in both halves, and they go into a totally different mode, right? What do? They call plays from the line of scrimmage. They hustle back to the line of scrimmage, call plays without even going into the huddle. They perform at a higher level. And that's what you and I believe, are to be doing right now. We're to be operating in a two-minute offense. Peter says the end is near. Let's start praying, my friends, because the two-minute warning has sounded. Many of us will be up at the LA Memorial Coliseum for a prayer event. Listen, next Saturday is going to be a long day. For many of us, it's going to start about 3 a.m. when you wake up, and you're going to drive to L.A. And you're going to be there from 7 a.m. for this event to 10:30. Then you're going to drive back. It's going to be a great full day. But it's going to be about praying with a sense of urgency. I wanted you to take a look at this quick clip about what's in store.
In John 17, Yeshua prayed that these and those would be one as he and the Father are one. These and those are the Jewish followers of Messiah and those of the nation. It says that when we join together, that all the world will know that the Father sent Yeshua, the Messiah, and we will be perfected in unity. We believe it's time for Jew and Gentile in Messiah to unite like never before, because when we unite, we believe there is going to be an incredible outpouring and awakening of God's Spirit. And I know that is what, Lou, you are believing for. Yeah. Another Azusa revival and awakening in our nation.
Absolutely. You know, it's 50 years ago, 1967, the Jesus movement and the messianic movement began to explode. We believe the whole world is ripe for another great awakening. I want to invite you to come to be a part of the solemn assembly moving into praying for the sick and preaching the gospel at the Memorial Coliseum on April 9th, 2016. It's the 110th anniversary of the Azusa Street Revival. We believe God's going to open up every well of revival as we're rightly aligned with the Jewish peoples right on down the line, that Jesus can pour out his Spirit, because we're in one place and in one accord.
Well, we're so excited. Listen, I don't know if you've ever heard the stories, but there are stories of rabbis coming to know Messiah during the Azusa Street outpouring, and of Jewish people coming to know Messiah. Incredible stories, and we believe what God did then, he wants to do again. And this event is on the first day, Rosh Chodesh Nisan, the first day of the month of Nisan, the month of miracles. So we are going to come out, stand with our brother, Jew and Gentile, united in unity, and see what God is going to do for our state and for our nation.
Biblical New Year's Day, keep us in prayer. We're going to be standing with our brother, Rabbi Jason. He's a good friend, and we're going to see some amazing things, but we're supposed to be praying today. The point is, with a sense of urgency. When you face an urgent situation, the first thing you should do is do what? Pray. When Yeshua was facing the tree of sacrifice, he went into a garden and prayed. How many of you have been in that garden in Israel? Yes. He told his disciples to do what? Watch and pray. We need to pray for Adonai to send forth laborers into the harvest. Pray that Adonai will save people who don't know him today. Pray for boldness to share the good news of Yeshua. We need boldness in this hour. We need to pray. Prayer is the most noble and necessary ministry that God has entrusted to us. But my friends, how many of you know it's the most neglected of ministries? Prayer, proper prayer, is not an opiate. Proper prayer is not an escape. Proper prayer is a function of clear vision and of seeking even clearer vision from God. It's only through communication with headquarters that we as soldiers can effectively stand. In other words, we're not to be escaping reality. We're to be grasping it. By the way, the more that I grow as a believer, the more I recognize that praying in the Holy Spirit is not a passive thing. It is somewhat violent. And as you and I pray for the kingdom of God to come, we are doing battle, holy battle, against the kingdom of darkness. It's going to be a great time next Saturday. For those of you who want to watch it, I believe either God TV or Daystar is going to be covering it live around the world as well. You can take a look at that when you get home from service if you're going to be here. Number two, we're to love, Peter says, with a show of hospitality. How are we to live in the last days? Prayer with a sense of urgency. Love with a show of hospitality. This one's convicting. Love each other deeply, he says. Why? Because love covers a multitude of sins. Offer hospitality, he says. I wish it wasn't in here because it's so hard to do. Without what? Grumbling. And he gives us a couple of important aspects about this love in this passage. He says it covers sin, covers a multitude of sins. This doesn't mean to us that when we love, it covers our sins. It means the best kind of love covers the sins of the person we are loving. Solomon writes in Proverbs 10:12, love covers up all transgressions. And the language both in this verse and in the one in Proverbs of covering sin is a reference, actually harkens back to what we find in Torah, Genesis chapter 9, where we find Noah planting a vineyard, growing grapes and getting into the winemaking business, right? He was sampling his own wine and got so drunk that what happened? He took off his clothes, right? His grown sons could have laughed at their father Noah, could have put shame to their father, but because they loved him, they covered his nakedness. Two of them slipped into the room, you recall, that night with a cloak. They walked backwards so that they wouldn't see his nakedness. They placed the cloak over him to cover Noah. Why? Because they loved him. And that's what the scripture means when Paul writes about it to the Corinthians, 1 Corinthians 13, 5, that says, love keeps no account of wrongs. This is tough. Hear my heart today. Get rid of your list. If there's somebody you know who needs your love, is there somebody that you know today, as God brings them to your remembrance, who needs your love? When you love them like Noah's boys, you are doing what? Covering a multitude of sins. Love covers sin, but love cares for strangers. Tough to do. Look at verse 9 again. One of the most visible expressions of love, he says, is hospitality, which is different from entertaining. Many of us love to entertain. It's not the same thing as hospitality. Don't confuse the two. Entertaining, what does that involve? It involves having your good friends in your home, people you know you're going to enjoy. Hospitality, on the other hand, is inviting strangers into your home without knowing a lot about them. In entertaining, the focus is on the host. The focus is on the beautiful home. The focus is on the beautiful cooking. In hospitality, the focus is on the need of the guest. Hospitality goes against our self-centered nature. And I am guilty, Lord. Whenever you fly in an airplane, you defy gravity. It requires the efforts of thrust and lift of the wings, but gravity does eventually get overcome. And hospitality, likewise, is like flying. It takes effort. But when we express hospitality to strangers, what are we doing? We're overcoming those laws, not thrust and lift. We're overcoming the law of selfishness. It isn't natural. And it isn't easy. And that's why he says to do hospitality without grumbling, because that would be the natural thing to do. The earliest messianic believers, we find, opened their homes to one another. They had to. The body of Messiah would have not continued, would have had difficulty surviving. These early messianics, culturally and contextually, were being persecuted. They were being forced to flee to other cities, and thus they needed some places to live. There were no buildings, by the way, until the 3rd century or so after Yeshua, and therefore the early believers had to meet for worship in the homes of other believers. And that's why it's important to have fellowship occurring in homes as well as in the congregation. We find in Genesis chapter 18 that Abraham, our father, demonstrated what is termed here hospitality. We remember that three strangers approached his property. They were malachim, they were angels, but they looked like ordinary men, right? And Abraham didn't realize who they were until later. And what did he do? I love it. He welcomed them, right? He washed their feet and he fed them. And what a powerful lesson for us. If we never open our home to strangers, we may miss one of the greatest opportunities on earth to meet angels. My son, many of you know him, he played basketball at Patrick Henry over the last 4 years. Man, I was having constant strangers in my home all the time, many of whom I was afraid of physically. They were 6'6", and I didn't know who these kids were. We just welcomed them. And that's just, of course, a small opportunity. But he fed them. And I felt, as I was looking at this verse, I thought to myself, what an amazing opportunity that most of us in our lives are missing here. The scriptures say in Hebrews 13, do not neglect to show this hospitality to strangers. Why? For in so doing, some have entertained angels without knowing it. How many of you have had that experience? Some of you have. It's an amazing thing. Pray with a sense of urgency. Love with a show of hospitality. And finally, as we take it up today, serve with a spirit of authority. Each of us, Peter writes, is to use whatever gift that we have received to do what? To serve others. Faithfully administering the grace of Adonai in its various forms. Now, depending on how you might count scripturally, there are between 14 to 18 different spiritual gifts mentioned in the New Covenant scriptures. The most important thing that though we can discover here in 1 Peter 4 is that spiritual gifts basically fall into two broad categories. Number one, the speaking gifts, and number two, gifts of service. Some of you here have the ability to preach. Some of you here have the ability to teach well. Some of you have the ability to use your words here to encourage and strengthen the needs of others, to encourage other people. Others of you feel less adequate for those tasks. You don't feel comfortable speaking. No problem. You may have an ability to change diapers in the nursery. Hello? Or to do hospital visitations. Thank you, Sharpie, and others who have done them for us. Or set up chairs and tables and take them down. That these are gifts as well. But whatever your gift is today, you need to employ it, Peter says, with the authority of God. If your gift is teaching and preaching, Peter says what? Deliver the word. Just because Las Colinas doesn't want to receive the word doesn't mean she's not going to stop delivering God's message. If your gift is serving, what's the strategy? Depend on the strength of God. How many of you know serving God can be physically draining? Physically draining. And that, if we try to do that in our own strength, Peter writes, and others, we will fail. But God's strength, Peter writes, is available. It's available. One of the heroes of our faith, probably most of you have never heard of him. Over the last couple of hundred years, his name was Hudson Taylor. How many of you have heard that name before? Oh, actually a good portion of you. Well, those of you who don't, in 1849, he was a 17-year-old bored teenager. Raised in a wealthy home of believers, he had no interest in scriptural matters. He had no interest in spiritual things. And those of you who have teenage children who maybe, like Hudson in his early years, be encouraged here. He was extremely shy. He spent much of his days reading. And one day he was so bored, he found a pamphlet that referred to the millions of people in China who had never heard about Yeshua. And that very instant, that very day, God broke his heart. And from that day on, his passion was to share the love of God with the Chinese people. At age 21, he traveled to China, and he began trying to spread the good news of Yeshua, but his first years were frustrating because very few people were responding to his message. Reminds me of when I was dispatched here at Tree of Life. I was 29 and a half years old, and I had people literally come up to me and say, Joel, we just can't receive from you. Yeshua was 30. We just can't receive from you until you're 30. So I waited them out 6 months. I hadn't changed, but they felt a whole lot better. Well, it reminds me kind of like Hudson Taylor in China. They weren't receiving him. He was 21 years old, but there was a reason why as well. One day, a Chinese man, a wise one, pointed out that Hudson's English suit, who's from Britain, had extra buttons on the sleeves and the backs, but there were no buttonholes, and he asked why. And Hudson Taylor realized his English-style dress was actually a distraction to his listeners. And so from that point on, he determined to speak Mandarin and dress in the Chinese custom. He discovered God didn't want the Chinese to become English believers, but to become Chinese believers. I think that speaks to us in Messianic Judaism today. He later returned to England, where he translated the New Covenant into Chinese and convinced others to join him in China. He returned with several other missionaries and actually married one of them. Hudson Taylor faced many hardships, including actually the death of his wife and his child, but God gave him the strength to maintain his work. He was small in stature, physically weak as well, but because he trusted Adonai, today he is considered a spiritual giant. My mom's been to China to minister, probably heard a lot about Hudson Taylor. If you'd come forward, Mom, as well. He devoted 50 years of his life to sharing the love of God with the Chinese. And as a result of his work over those decades, when he died in 1905, there were 250 mission stations and over 100,000 new Chinese believers. Amen. The secret of his effectiveness was that he learned what Peter says here, to depend upon the strength of God instead of his own strength. My friends, if you want to experience, stand with me today. If we want to experience true fulfillment in our lives, we must learn the secret that Hudson Taylor discovered. He wrote this, quote, I myself, for instance, am not especially gifted, am shy by nature, but my gracious and merciful God and Father inclined himself to me. And when I was weak in faith, he strengthened me while I was still young. He taught me in my helplessness to rest on him and to pray even about little things in which another might have felt able to help himself. He said that through his life, he went through three stages of understanding about the secrets of the strength of God. He said, quote, I used to ask God if he would come and help me. And later I asked God if I might come and help him. And then I ended by asking God to do his work through me. I hope we've made that discovery today. If so, our lives will take on an amazing purpose. Here's how. Pray like never before, because God's clock is winding down. Show love to others so deeply. Welcome strangers into your life. And finally, give your life away to others. But do it in the strength of God. And so as we close today, as we live under every day of the shadow of history's wrap-up, we are to be rejoicing in the hope of his soon return. Hope is a contented expectation. Hope does not involve anxiety over his return. It's going to be like the ancient Jewish wedding. The groom was going to return at a certain time, and the bride was to have her oil in her lamp, because every day she lived like he was going to return that day. Rejoicing in that hope is to be the helium of the Holy Spirit. What is helium? It's going to lift you up every day past all the disappointments. The helium of the Holy Spirit is going to lift you up every day past the discouragements, past the difficulties, past the trials, past the temptations. Let us rejoice today in the hope of the Messiah's coming, knowing that in that day we're going to stand before His glorious presence, faultless, with exceedingly great joy. One of my favorite letters in all of Scripture. Father God, we thank You and praise You for this hope. We thank You and praise You that You've not called us to live like the pagans or to live like our culture. Thank You, Lord, that You've inclined our heart to run from sin and not toward it. Thank You, God, that You've anointed our minds to pray with a sense of urgency. Father, as we pray for the state of California next Shabbat and for our nation, we're literally erecting idols in New York City later this month. Father, we pray for a revival in our nation, a spiritual renewal, dear God, an epic shift on the landscape of our planet. So, Father, as we gather for a holy assembly, those even around the world via simulcast, we ask You, Lord, humbly by Your Spirit, fall on us. Father, we desperately need You today. We're not going to solve these problems without You. Politics is not going to solve these problems without You. Social programs are not going to carry us. Lord, we need a sovereign move of Your Spirit to change the hearts, to change our hearts. So, Father, we're thankful, we're grateful to You for Your Word, for each other. Thank You for inhabiting our praises and our worship today. Thank You for even the smallest acts of servants, of service that go on here on a weekly basis, for whatever we've done to the least of these, Your brethren, You've done to us, You've done to You. So, Father, whether it is changing a diaper in that nursery, or whether it is teaching a Shabbat school class, whether it's taking out tables and chairs, whatever it is, Lord, we do it with Your strength. With Your strength. Renew our strength as the eagle, dear God. For those in their 80s here, renew their strength, Lord, today. In Yeshua's name. Heal up the brokenhearted. Bind up their wounds today, Lord. As You encourage each heart. We bless You and we thank You in Your name. Amen. Hallelujah. Well, receive His blessing today. I want to wish you all a good Shabbos and a Shavua Tov as we leave. We'll be back here next Shabbat with a wonderful, great, encouraging speaker. A worship team will be here. And we want to bless you today. Yivarechech Adonai v'yishma recha. Ya'er Adonai pan v'lecha v'chunecha. Yisha Adonai pan velecha v'yashem lecha shalom. So may the Lord bless you and keep you today. May the Lord make His face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you. May Adonai lift up His countenance above you and grant you peace. In the name of the Sar Shalom, the Prince of Peace, Yeshua of Nazareth, and His people said with us, Amen. 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 Shabbat Shalom, everybody.
Amen. Please stay and sing with us the last song.